Good day and welcome to Big Bad Tech. I'm your instructor, Jim Pytel. Today's topic of discussion is 2- and 3-wire magnetic motor starters. Our objective is to take a brief look at 2- and 3-wire control circuits for magnetic motor starters. We'll discuss applications fitting their use, differences between them, and important safety considerations. This lecture operates under the assumption you have watched the contactors, overloads, manual motor starters, and basic ladder logic lectures, all available at the Big Bad Tech channel. If you haven't watched these lectures yet, or only dimly recall their contents, please take the time to do so now. As you'll recall, a contactor paired with an overload element form the two necessary components for a motor starter, being one, a means of starting or stopping the motor by making or breaking an electrical connection, the contactor, and two, a means of protecting the motor from sustained overload conditions, the overload. A contactor and overload can be integrated into a single package called a motor starter, or the pair working in combination can be considered a motor starter. Later lectures will cover various incantations of magnetic motor starters, including reversing magnetic motor starters, jogging or inching circuits, plugging circuits, and more. Magnetic motor starters are those motor starters that receive a start signal via remote means, typically through the magnetic interaction of a pilot-level control signal and coil. Magnetic motor starters are for applications requiring remote control or additional functionality. In contrast, a manual motor starter is one where the motor is controlled at the point of use by an operator. Recall that a contactor is characterized by a set of primary contacts that close when the magnetically linked coil is energized by pilot voltage. When the coil from A1 to A2 is energized by pilot voltage, typically 120 volts AC or 24 volts DC as representative examples, the primary L2T contacts would close. The L2T primary contacts are rated to make or break connection to 208 volts or 480 volt industrial three-phase AC voltage as representative examples. Contactors sometimes feature an auxiliary pilot contact from terminals 1-3 to 1-4 that changes to its opposite state when the coil is energized. If the application necessitates additional functionality, an auxiliary contact block can be utilized that includes other auxiliary pilot-level contacts. When the coil is energized by pilot voltage, these auxiliary contacts would also change to their opposite states. Note the first digit in the terminal numbers for a contactor, pilot contacts, identify a particular switch, and the second digit indicates that particular switch's deactivated state. A 1-2 switch would be normally closed. A 3-4 switch would be normally open. Recall that an overload is a sensory device characterized by heater elements from the L2T terminals rated to carry primary current. If the heater elements detect a sustained overload condition, the pilot level auxiliary contacts would change to their opposite state. This particular overload features a normally closed contact from 9-5 to 9-6 and a normally open contact from 9-7 to 9-8. Don't ask me why they start with 9. Only after the overload has cooled can the overload be reset. Depending on which operational mode the overload is in, the reset may necessitate direct acknowledgement and intervention by a technician manually resetting it, or the overload may automatically reset itself. Overloads often feature a trip indicator. A technician seeing the overload triggered would know that the motor has been subjected to a thermal overload. Motors subjected to repeat thermal overloads may be damaged. For this reason, overloads should be trip-free, where the term trip-free means that the overload cannot be held in the reset position while the overloads are hot. Upon closure of the primary M contactor, this application would be a magnetic full-voltage motor starter, sometimes called a direct online or across-the-line starter. Full voltage means exactly that. The motor is instantaneously and directly connected to full voltage upon closure of the primary contacts. Such an event is characterized by a large surge of current, known as inrush. Inrush current can be around 6 times normal full load current, and direct online motor starters must be obviously rated to carry this amount. Inrush current, although intense and undesirable from a distribution standpoint, is ordinarily brief. As the motor comes up to rated speed, increasing counter-electromotive force, sometimes called CEMF, opposes the applied voltage and current quickly drops to a reasonable level. The electromagnetic interaction lecture available at the Big Bad Tech channel, discusses the CEMF phenomenon. If, however, a motor is subjected to a high inertial load, an industrial three-phase AC system lost a phase, or the rotor somehow locked due to a misaligned shaft or bad bearings, the inrush condition could continue. It is for this reason overloads are included in a motor starter. The overload elements in series with the contactor in the motor is intended to protect, detect the sustained current, and signal the contacts to open. This fact bears repetition. The overloads upon sensing a sustained overload do not directly break connection. They are sensory devices only. The contactor is the one and only element that makes or breaks connection to the supply voltage. The contactor makes or breaks connection at the request of the pilot ladder logic diagram. Magnetic motor starters are divided into two general categories, two-wire and three-wire control circuits. Two-wire circuits are ordinarily characterized by automatic switches, like temperature, float, or pressure switches, and are suited for applications in which the automatic starting of a motor would not present a safety hazard. Three-wire circuits, in contrast, are ordinarily characterized by momentary switches, like push buttons, and a holding circuit. A three-wire control circuit is suitable for applications where the unexpected starting of a motor would present a safety hazard. Let's examine a two-wire control circuit first, since they're the easiest. This example illustrates the logic behind a 480-volt, three-phase AC, industrial exhaust fan. The ladder logic diagram for the circuit couldn't be any simpler. Pilot voltage is supplied by a control transformer stepping down the 480-volt AC line-to-line voltage to a suitable 120-volt AC pilot level. The first and only rung in the pilot ladder logic is a series connection of a normally open temperature switch, TS1, the F contactor coil, and the normally closed overload contacts. When the temperature rises to the predetermined set point, the normally open temperature switch closes. Via the now closed temperature switch and the normally closed overload contact, the F contactor coil is energized. The energized F contactor coil closes the primary F contactor. Full voltage is applied to the stator windings of the fan motor. The motor experiences inrush current and begins rotating. Once the fan reaches rated speed, the inrush current subsides and levels out at the full load rated current. After a sufficient quantity of hot air has been exhausted, temperature in the condition space drops and the temperature switch reaches its reset value and reopens. The F coil is de-energized and the primary F contacts open. The fan free spins to a halt. Later lectures will discuss friction brakes and electrically assisted means of bringing motors to a rapid halt. Consider what would happen if during the course of exhausting the space, a piece of debris fell into the fan and locked the rotor in place. The locked rotor condition would beget unusually high current, and after a period of time, the overload elements would heat up and the normally closed overload contact would open. The now open overload contact de-energizes the F contactor coil, and the primary F contacts open, de-energizing the motor. This illustrates the basic function of a two-wire control circuit. The fan cools the space with no human intervention, and electrical connection is made or broken by the contactor at the direction of the temperature switch. In the event of an overload, the motor is protected by the overload relay. The title two-wire control circuit is derived from the two wires leading to the controlling element, in this case, temperature switch TS1. Consider an important fact about this circuit. If the primary supply voltage experienced a power outage, the fan would obviously not operate. However, upon reapplication of the supply voltage, the fan could restart suddenly if the temperature switch is still being actuated by a temperature in excess of the set point. It is for this reason two-wire control circuits are sometimes called low or no voltage release circuits. If there is a loss of primary power, the motor will de-energize. However, upon reapplication of primary power, the motor will restart if the control devices remain closed. For obvious reasons, two-wire control circuits are used only in applications where the automatic restart characteristic is desirable and there is no danger of injury. Pumps, fans, and compressors are common applications of two-wire low voltage release, magnetic motor starters. Returning to our previous overload scenario, consider if the overload relay were in automatic reset mode. After sensing the initial overload due to a locked rotor, the open overload contact would have de-energized the primary F contactor. The overload elements would cool until such a time that they reset. In the automatic reset mode, this means the F contactor coil will automatically be energized if the temperature switch was still closed. If the rotor was still locked due to a piece of entangled debris, the overload condition would repeat itself if the temperature switch remained closed. Consider the safety repercussions of this scenario. If you are a technician that has been tasked with the investigation of this fan's repeated overload, the fan could restart the moment the overloads cool. For this reason, overloads for some applications are placed in the manual reset mode, necessitating manual acknowledgement of the overload condition before being reset. The causes leading up to the overload can be investigated and resolved before the overload is manually reset. For this reason, manual motor starters are sometimes placed in series with a magnetic motor starter for applications necessitating functional isolation. Despite the fan being started or stopped remotely via the temperature switch and magnetic motor starter, the manual motor starter upstream serves as a means of disconnecting and disabling the motor for service, as well as an additional level of circuit protection. If the control transformer were upstream of the manual motor starter, the pilot ladder logic would be free to function, perhaps control other motors. If the control transformer were downstream of the manual motor starter, the pilot ladder logic would be disabled with a fan. A technician could open the manual motor starter, lock it out and tag it out, and service the motor. Regardless, signals to the magnetic F contactor would serve no purpose because the motor has been effectively isolated from primary voltage. Let's now examine a three-wire control circuit. This example illustrates the logic behind a three-phase AC industrial motor. The ladder logic diagram for this circuit features a holding circuit we introduced in the basic ladder logic lecture. Let's say pilot voltage is applied by a control transformer stepping down the line-to-line voltage to a suitable pilot level or a DC power supply. The first rung consists of a maintain contact, normally closed E-stop, in series with a momentary contact, normally closed stop push button, in series with a momentary contact, normally open start push button, in series with an M contactor coil, in series with a normally closed overload contact. The second rung includes the holding contact M1 associated with the M contactor, in parallel to the momentary contact, normally open, start push button. The title three-wire control circuit is derived from the three wires leading to the controlling elements. In this case, the combined normally closed E-stop, normally closed stop, and normally open start buttons. Importantly, a three-wire control circuit is instantly recognizable because it has a holding circuit and uses momentary switches. If an operator were to press the start button, the momentary normally open start switch would close. And via the closed E-stop, the closed stop, the now closed start, and the closed overload contact, the coil of the M contactor would be energized. When the coil of the M contactor energizes, its associated contacts change states. The normally open M1 holding contact in rung 2 closes, and the primary M contacts close. The motor experiences inrush current and begins rotating. Once the motor reaches rated speed, the inrush current subsides and levels out at the full load rated current. If an operator were to release the momentary contact start button, the spring return will return it to its normally open deactivated state. Note that the now closed M1 holding contact maintains the energized state of the M contactor coil. This means the primary M contactor stays closed and the motor continues spinning. That's the point of the holding circuit. It maintains the last asserted state. To stop the motor, an operator must press the normally closed stop button. The now open stop de-energizes the M contactor coil and the associated contacts return to their de-energized state. The M1 holding contact opens, removing the path in parallel to the start push button. The M contactor primary contacts open and the motor free spins to a halt. Notice while in its natural deactivated closed state, the maintain contact E-stop in no way, shape, or form affects functionality of the system. When an operator presses and releases start, the motor starts, and the holding contact maintains this last asserted state. When an operator presses and releases stop, the motor stops, ready to initiate another start cycle. If, however, an operator were to observe an unsafe scenario, by hitting the maintained e-stop, the motor would stop and the system would be disabled. Importantly, due to the maintained rather than the momentary nature of the e-stop, the system will remain disabled until the e-stop is reset. The start button would not energize the M contactor coil, and as such, the primary M contacts would not close despite repeated attempts to do so. That's the point. The maintained e-stop has disabled the system. Only after the e-stop has been reset and returned to the closed position can the system now start the motor. Similar to our previous discussion of two-wire control circuits, the normally closed overload contact would de-energize the M contactor coil should the overloads detect a sustained thermal overload. Compare and contrast the behavior of this three-wire control circuit with the behavior of our previous two-wire control circuit experiencing a power loss or overload. When power is lost, obviously the motor won't work. However, upon restoration of power, the motor will not automatically restart since the holding circuit drops out. For this reason, three-wire control circuits are often called low or no voltage protection circuits, and that an operator is protected from an errant unexpected restart. Only when an operator makes the conscious decision to restart the motor by actively pressing the start button does it do so. Similar to our previous discussion involving two-wire control circuits, manual motor starters can be placed in series with a magnetic motor starter controlled by a three-wire circuit for applications necessitating functional isolation. Despite the motor being started or stopped remotely via push-button station and magnetic motor starter, the manual motor starter upstream serves as a means of disconnecting and disabling the motor for service, as well as an additional level of circuit protection. If the control transformer were upstream of the manual motor starter, the pilot ladder logic would be free to function, perhaps control other motors. If the pilot ladder logic were downstream of the manual motor starter, the pilot ladder logic would also be disabled with the motor. A technician could open the manual motor starter, lock it out, tag it out, and service the motor. Regardless, signals to the magnetic M contactor would serve no purpose because the manual motor starter effectively isolates the motor from primary voltage. All right, this about wraps up our brief introduction to two and three wire control circuits for magnetic motor starters. We'll be making use of these configurations in later lectures as a means of remotely making and breaking electrical connection to and protecting motors from sustained overload conditions. Before we close up shop, let's do a quick review and comparison of the two methodologies. A two-wire control circuit has two wires leading to the controlling elements. Ordinarily, two-wire control circuits are composed of automatic switches, like temperature, pressure, or float switches. Two-wire control circuits are suitable for applications in which the automatic starting of a motor is a desirable characteristic. These circuits are commonly called low or no voltage release circuits, and that a power failure will de-energize the motor. However, upon restoration of power, the motor may automatically start if the controlling element is still closed. Two-wire control circuits do not use a holding circuit. A three-wire control circuit, in contrast, has three wires leading to the controlling elements and incorporates a holding circuit. Ordinarily, three-wire control circuits are composed of momentary switches like push buttons. Three-wire control circuits are suitable for applications in which the automatic starting of a motor is not a desirable characteristic. These circuits are commonly called low or no voltage protection circuits, and that a power failure or overload will de-energize a motor. However, upon restoration of power, the motor will not automatically start until an operator makes the conscious decision to do so. In conclusion, this lecture took a brief look at magnetic motor starters. We discussed two and three wire control circuits and reviewed the holding circuit. We discussed applications fitting their use, differences between them, and important safety considerations. Remember to review these concepts as often as you need to really drive it home. Imagine how well lab will go if you know what you're doing. Thank you very much for your attention and interest, and we'll see you again during the next lecture of our series. Remember to tell your Lazy Lab partner about this resource, and be sure to check out the Big Bad Tech channel for additional resources and updates.